So, good morning. I am going to be your instructor for this week. 21 hours we are going to spend together. Additionally, we have also a social event. So my name is Bassam Al-Rifai. You can call me just Bassam. I will try to get rid of my of the flicker in my camera. But give me time in the break. I will take care of it. Today is my first time in the office after 3 months. So I was in home office, but I thought for the internet connection for the whole week, I would prefer to give the course from the office. So at the beginning of the day, I have to get the coffee machine turned on and stuff like this. So, yeah, Bassam, I am group leader at the RWTH Aachen University. I founded the group Cyber Physical Mobility here, and the lab you are going to experiment in has the same name, also Cyber Physical Mobility Lab. So I am with the chair of embedded software. And before that, I did my PhD in control engineering in the mechanical engineering department. And yeah, what else I would like to tell you about myself. Yeah, before that, I studied automation engineering. And the course we are going to have today is the course representing the work in our group and representing the goal of our cyber physical mobility lab. So it is not just myself. Also, one of my group members is going to assist me during this week. You are going to hear him a lot, so I will give him also the chance to introduce himself.
Yeah, hi everybody, I'm Patrick. I'm a group member in Bassam's group. I studied mechanical engineering in my bachelor's and then did automation engineering in my master's. I will mainly talk about the lab and support you when you're doing your work in the lab. So yeah, if you have questions about that anytime, feel free to let me know and I will happily answer them.
So every time we don't need the slides, I will not share the slides with you, and I will ask you to open your camera to see each other, to have interaction. I mean, if we were in the room, we would see each other and I would get visual feedback from you. But now I would like to start sharing my screen. I have to do some stuff here on my screen. So I have to move a window around. Yeah, you should now see the slides. So I am in this meeting with two accounts. It's myself. You're seeing me with my name, and Fortrag also. The member Fortrag is my tablet. So I'm going to share here the slides with you using my tablet, and I'm looking also to a camera in front of me where I also see you and see the slides, just for you to know what we how the setup is in my office. So the course is going to be about network model predictive control for multi-vehicle decision making. And we already introduced ourselves. I'm going to be your lecturer, and Patrick will take care of the lab and organizational stuff. So if you were in Aachen, you would see our university. That's why I will take the chance here to give you a short introduction to the RWTH Aachen University. So here you see some key data about the university. It's founded 151 years ago, and last year we celebrated the 150 years of RWTH Aachen. And I would not go through the numbers here. So I shared also the slides with you in the folder share out. And I shared also with you a folder shared in. So share in is what you would share with us and with your team members. And share out is what you get from us. So at the university, we have 10 schools. We call them Fakultäten, and we are in the school number one, Natural Sciences, Computer Science, and Math. And we are in the Computer Science department with a lot of students and professors. And our chair is the number 11, Embedded Software. And here you see a picture of the team members. 1 year ago, usually we go for the colloquia for our internal presentations to Austria, to the mountains there. We go skiing, and in the afternoon we have our presentations. And this was just before Corona. So in our chair, we have almost 20 researchers and a lot of graduate students. Remarkably here that we have three spin-off companies in the last 5 years from our chair. So the chair is divided into three groups: biomedical systems. They take care of supervision in medical devices and data analysis. In my group, you will going to know it in detail. We take care of network control systems and service-oriented architectures. And you will learn in this course a little bit about service-oriented architectures, but the main focus is going to be on network control systems. And we have also a group take care of formal methods with applications in industry automation. So about my group, we combine some disciplines in mobility to have our profile. So we have I use the laser pointer here. Yeah. So we have the area of control engineering, where we focus on network control and predictive control. We're going to learn about it in this course. We combine it with mathematical optimization. We look at convex and non-convex optimization, but we don't develop new methods for optimization. We use state-of-the-art optimization methods. And if you combine it with communications, you get here Network model predictive control. So control plus optimization plus communication, we have network model predictive control, and it is the first part of the title of this course. Yeah, in communication, we take care of data delays, of course, and data losses. So additionally, we have the area of embedded software in our group represented, where we take care of software architectures and certification of safety. So in this course, you're going just to learn a little bit about the software architecture. And we combine it, of course, with a perception system where we focus on localization systems and machine learning, but it is not going to be part of this course. So here you see the group members, and we host a lot of master's and bachelor students in our group. And also we host a team, a student team, which participate at a competition, international competition, but it's in Germany, in Braunschweig. Its name is Carolo Cup, where student teams come together, build a car model scale, and they should drive some scenarios defined by the organizers, and at the end of the day, a team wins. So if you are more interested, just Google for Carolo Cup, or if you are interested in our team, just Google for Team Galaxis. So now coming to you, participants, I would like also to get to know you. We are a small group. We have 15 participants, the participants are from 12 universities. We have 15 participants, but from 12 universities, and you are from 13 nationalities. So we have 13 languages here, and I counted the countries. I think we have 9 countries represented here. So we are a diverse team, and I would like to get to know a little bit about you, maybe 1 minute per participant, and what I would like to know about you, it was on the slide. Yeah, name, topic of your PhD, maybe your progress in the PhD, or if it is not PhD, what you are doing, how is your progress? You are in the first, second, third year, whatever, and your motivation or expectation from this course. So, I also organized you in teams, and if you go to the share out folder, you will see an Excel sheet with your names, emails, and a number representing your team. So later on, I will speak about the teams, but if you open it now, you can see the participants. I would suggest to go through through the list. So the first on my list is, I'll try to speak right. Maybe you can correct also my pronunciation about your names. Julia Treska?
Yes, it's right.
Ah, okay.
Okay, I'm Julia. I came from Italy, and I'm a PhD student at Polytechnic of Bari, that is in the south of Italy. I am a computer science engineering, but now I'm working in the Decision and Control Laboratory, which is in the Department of Automatic Engineering. And my PhD is focused on the dynamical vehicle routing. So this course is perfect for my PhD. I think that the notion that I will learn here can be very useful for me. And I think that that's all.
Yeah, how is your progress? In which year of PhD are you?
Till now, I'm developed an offline method of for doing the VRP. So it's not dynamical yet. And with a mixed integer linear programming, and it's a bit slow, so we are trying to get it faster. And then in the second part of the PhD, because now I'm in my first year.
Okay.
So it's pretty new, my research. And in the second part, I will move from the static, the offline VRP, to the online, the dynamical VRP.
Okay. So I understood you're using mixed integer programming in your
yes,
learning algorithms. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Your teammate is going to be Dennis Benders.
Hello.
Hello, Dennis. So you're going to be the teammate of Julia, and so please introduce yourself.
Yeah, so my name is Dennis. I'm working as a PhD in Delft, Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. I'm in the cognitive robotics department. So we develop all kinds of cognitive algorithms to run on robots. And we do that on several different kinds of robots. So we have a car, we have drones, so whatever you, underwater robots, vessels, so all kinds of robots. And I'm personally in the, actually the third or the first year, the third month of my PhD. And I'm working on the control of drones. So now I'm starting with robust control of a single drone, and I want to extend it with fault tolerant control of a single drone, and then move on to the multiple for formation control of these drones. So then network model predictive control will be very nice.
Okay, thank you. So we are going to use the example of ground vehicles in this course, but you can extend it to the third dimension. And it's more challenging, of course, with more dimensions. So the next on my list is Antonello Venturino.
Yes, that's my name. Hello. You hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so my name is Antonello. I graduated as computer engineering and after automation engineering in Italy. But currently I am a second year PhD student in France at Université Paris-Saclay. And I'm working on distributed state estimation with application on multi-robot systems. And also my approaches on for state estimation is the method moving horizon estimation, which is the counterpart for control of the MPC. So I think this course will give me more detail and something maybe I will need for my next researches. So, I am at the second year. Now we are doing something about moving horizon estimation on trying to reduce the computation time of the algorithm. And then maybe we'll go for experiments on real robots. So we need also controllers. So maybe it would be an MPC or any of this controller on networked systems. So I would like to follow this course.
Oh, nice, nice. So not completely the topic of this course, state estimation, but if you find ideas you can transfer to state estimation, it would be very nice. And as you said, the moving horizon estimation is the same as MPC, but you are looking to the past.
Yes.
Okay. So your teammate is going to be Chiao Chen.
Hello. Yeah, that's Hello. Correct. Hello, okay. Everyone. My name is Xiao Chen. I'm Chinese, but I live in Sweden, and I work as a PhD at KTH. If you know, it's in Sweden. And I'm at the Division of Decision and System Control Department here. I have my background in applied mathematics with like a main focus in actually optimization. And now my research is mainly focused on like traffic coordination near some intersection or like a general conflict region. So it's quite closely related with this multi-agent system. Like you need to kind of consider like all the vehicles near interest region. And right now I'm solving the problem as a mixed integer problem as well. And same as Julia. I also look at, for example, the impact of having platoon in the traffic, how that would affect the traffic throughput and all other like performance index for traffic in, related stuff. So this course I think will be very interesting, and also I had some experience in quite a bit of experience in MPC as well. So, but not that much in multi-agent or distributed MPC. So I think this will be a very interesting course for me.
Yeah. In which year of PhD are you?
I'm now currently at my second year.
Second year, okay.
Yeah.
So now coming to team number three, the next on my list is Joseph Matus.
Hi. I'm Josef.
Josef, okay.
Yeah. And my background is in electrical engineering. Specifically, I studied cybernetics, and now I'm doing my first year of PhD at the Norwegian University of Technology and Science, the NTNU. We are working with autonomous underwater vehicles. Specifically, we are developing control algorithms for flocks or fleets, swarms of underwater vehicles.
Okay, nice. So, 11, 12 years ago, I also worked on a project for underwater vehicles, and it is really exciting to have them also in as a multi-agent system. So it's really nice. So in team number three, we have Joy El-Firali.
So hello, everyone. I'm Joy Ferrari, and I'm actually on my second year in PhD. I will tell you about my background. I studied electrical engineering and did my master's in automatic engineering. And for the PhD, I'm working on modeling multi-physics systems and controlling them. So multi-physics system is like building the electric grids and heating districts. So I'm in the phase of modeling them and reducing their order. So the next phase is to control these systems. And well, actually, this course is not it's not related to my PhD, but I'm interested to learn about this field and the multi-agent system.
Okay, yeah, you're also welcome. Have I understood you're doing model reduction in your PhD?
Yes.
Okay, it's also very exciting. Yeah. Which methods are you using?
Well, actually, now we're trying a new method about it's related to the energy of the components. We're working on a software called Modelica. So it's kind of, we're trying a new method of to this specific types of. Of models in Modelica.
So. Okay, nice. Okay. The next team on my list is team number 4, and we have Ivan Kvok. Or
hi, it's Ivan Cvok.
Cvok.
Cvok. Yeah. Okay, I'm Ivan from University of Zagreb, and I'm a third year PhD student here. My background is in mechatronics and robotics, and that's also the course of my study for PhD. The topic of my PhD deals with model predictive control of electric vehicle HVAC systems, but I'm also working on active suspension systems, vehicle dynamics, and automatic transmission controls. And I chose this course because I'd like to broaden my knowledge in autonomous vehicle controls, and this fits it perfectly. So I'm looking forward to learning this networked MPC. And basically that's it. Thank you.
Ah, exciting. You can also apply network decision making to reduce energy consumption in electrical vehicles. So you will also maybe find application of this course.
Yeah, that could be exciting, yeah. As well. Yeah.
Okay. So the next on the list is your teammate Ivan. It's going to be Anastasios Tsolakis. Anastasios. Okay, I will try to learn the name. He is not here. Okay. So now you know who is your teammate. The next is Matthias Pedrosa. So Matthias, I know you, but maybe you would like to introduce yourself to the group here.
Yeah, sure. So hello everyone, I'm Matthias. I am a computer engineering, but I did my master's in control engineering. And now I'm on my first year PhD at University of Saarbrücken University in Germany. And yeah, so I'm in a project with Bassam and Patrick. So this course will be very interesting for me to understand networked control system, because I think this would be complementary for me. So yeah.
Thank you, Matthias. So we have a huge project in Germany. We call them large projects. It is a priority program of our research association here, and in such priority programs, we have a lot of projects. I think we have 15 in this priority program. The name is Cooperatively Interacting Automobiles. And we have a joint project with Matthias, and his supervisor professor is Katrin Flaskamp at the University of Saarland. And Patrick and Matthias work in the same project. So it is so they will continue the cooperation also after this course. So Matthias, you are going to work with Erdem Dilmen.
Hello to everyone. I'm Erdem Dilmen. I'm about to complete my PhD thesis in these days. I actually graduated from electrical and electronics engineering. My search topic is based on using adaptive support vector machines for modeling and control. In my thesis, I designed a disturbance observer based on a proposed recurrent support vector machine and used it in combination with a slide model observer. It actually performed estimation of the disturbance, and I employed it within the slide mode control scheme of a quadrotor type UAV. So this course, I'm actually interested in also mobile robots or autonomous vehicles. So this course caught my eye, and so I'm interested in this course, and I want to attend this course.
Okay. And in which year of PhD are you?
I'm about to complete my PhD thesis in these days. It's about to finish.
Okay. And your presentation is going to be online?
Yeah, very soon.
Okay. Nice. So, now we move on to the team number 6, and we have, I don't know which is the first and which is the second name, Amour Manel. I assume Manel is the first name.
Yes. My name is Amour Manel. I'm a second year PhD student in France at Université de Haute-Alsace. Actually, I have an electrical background in electrical and control engineering. And my topic for my PhD is about collaborative control strategies to control multi-vehicles in collision avoidance application. And I have chosen to work on model predictive control. But I didn't yet started to work on multi-agent system. So I wanted to participate in this course in order to be like a boost for me to start working on multi-agent system using model predictive control. And maybe the notion that I'm gonna learn here are going to help me to improve some strategies to solve my problem.
Yeah, for sure. It is... completely the right course for you. And we have in team number 6, Victoria Alonso.
Good morning, everybody. Sorry, because the light is a bit... there is the sun here. I live in Madrid. I work at Technical University of Madrid, I have a position like as a teaching assistant in electrical engineering, electrical circuits, electronics, a little bit of automatic control, and I have to, well, I don't know how to explain, because everybody has his research lines here and very organized, but to be honest, I don't know what I'm going to do exactly, because in a department where a lot of people have retired recently, and well, there are a lot of movements, and what I'm doing now is I'm doing, for example, all the courses that I can do from the ECI to learn and to see what what also I'm doing, because I love learning things and is when I see something, but it's true that it's good to have an objective and to, because it's something that I have to improve, because especially when I see something new that I don't know, I have to do this because I want to learn something about. And also I like to see new groups and the work. For example, I have made several courses, and in each course the people have a different way of work, a different way of do the things, and I love to learn that type of things. About the topic of the course, I'm also interested in the control of several electrical machines at the same time. It's more distributed control, but and the part of model predictive control I like also, because I like the all the things related to optimization, because during the when I was studying, I have a professor, a very good professor in optimization, that I'm not good in optimization, but he makes me want to know more about, and well, during the course and the social events, well, we can talk and we can share more things. Thank you very much for organizing the course and for the opportunity of, in those circumstances, follow the and learn new things. Thank you.
Maybe you can transfer this course to a course at your university if you would like. Yeah. So the next team consists of three members, because we have 15 participants. And the first member is Maximilian Bauer.
Yeah, it's me. Hello, everyone. My name is Maximilian Bauer. I'm a PhD student at the University of Darmstadt, so also in Germany. I'm at the very beginning of my second year in PhD, and my research is focusing on urban air traffic management. So basically, I'm trying to develop collision avoidant algorithms for unmanned aerial vehicles. So I'm trying to use the methods shown here to try to apply it on aerial vehicles. And yeah, we'll see how this will work.
Okay, exciting. What kind of air vehicles are you considering? Flying taxis?
At the beginning, not. I'm more focused on the below 25 kilogram limits, but maybe the methods can be scaled to larger vehicles.
Okay, nice. So in this team, we have also Behdad Aminian.
Yes. Hello, everybody. Can you hear me?
Okay. Hello.
Okay. Hello, everybody. I'm Behdad Aminian. My background is I studied software engineering as a bachelor, and then I studied communication systems in my master. And now recently I started my PhD in Norwegian University of Science and Technology in TNU. And I'm working on the underwater vehicle systems, like as Joseph. And my focus area is about underwater communication. I'm going to apply distributed optimization for underwater communication system. And That's it. It's in short, I think. Okay. It's a short summary of my I have in my background.
Yeah. In which year of PhD?
I just started a few months ago.
Just started.
So I'm in the first year, yes.
Okay. So I didn't know that about the underwater stuff. I don't know if a team switch makes sense, that Joseph and Beda work together. We can see. So I'll check for it. And the last but not least is Bikash Adhikari.
Hi, I'm Vikas Adhikari. I'm from Nepal and I'm currently doing my PhD in automatic control at Automatic Control Research Center at Nancy University of Lorraine. So I basically work on developing a reduced order model for synchronizing the multi-agent systems. I'm currently in the second year of my PhD. So basically we use the singular perturbation techniques to approximate the synchronizing behavior of the network.
Okay. So your main focus is synchronization of
exactly.
Autonomous systems.
I work basically on theoretical aspects, so we do not, you know, distinguish between autonomous or such types. So I believe this course will let me know more about the problems and all we face in while we do the applications.
Okay. So, thank you for the introductions. I don't know, Anastasios is still missing? Okay. Then we will continue. We'll see if we make team changes. So the teams are going to work together in the lab. And I tried to make diverse teams and to consider your backgrounds and your the form you answered last week. Not all of you who answered, I considered your pre-knowledge and put you to together to have the different backgrounds in a team. For example, if you are more into programming and software, I put you with somebody with more background in on control. So I hope the teams I chose are good choice, but if you if you think you would like to change the team, it's no problem. We can also make teams of three. Until now we have teams of two, but in case you think you cannot progress together because the backgrounds don't match, so it's no problem, just tell us and we can make arrangements. So I'll share my slides again to finish the introduction. At this point, if we were in the room, if you were in Aachen, we would visit the lab, but you are not there, so we will do it virtually. So it is a virtual visit. For this visit, I would suggest that you go to our website of the lab, cpm.embedded.rwth-aachen.de, and take a look at the website. Details about the lab will follow today in the afternoon. Patrick is going to tell you more about that technical stuff in the lab. So I told you last year, the RWTH got 150 years old, and for the movie, because of Corona, nobody was allowed to be there. I think I have to change something in my presentation. I had this issue, and I think it has something with my, I am here. So it is set up to change slides automatically, and I have to change it. So, and for this, for the movie, I was interviewed by a moderator of maybe just Maximilian and Patrick, and maybe Matthias know the moderator. She is Shari Reeves, the one from the Sendung mit der Maus and Wissen macht A. So she is famous in German TV. And yeah, if you want to get an impression about the lab, just click on this YouTube video. And yeah, the part of the lab is, I don't know, about two minutes. So in the break, just click on the YouTube video, and you can see a video of the lab. And we have also subtitles in English and in Chinese. So if you would like to understand the interview also. Yeah, in the main idea of the lab is to see ideas developing into reality, something between simulation and real world experiments, and something where we get excited for research, where students and researchers have ideas and go to the lab and see something moving around, and this motivates people to do research. Yeah, and yeah, this slide will be shown and will be discussed in detail in the afternoon by Patrick, but I'll just mention the headlines. So the main features of the lab is to be open source and remotely accessible. So for open source, we published the code of the lab, the plans, the construction plans, and the documentation on the web. You find the code on GitHub, the plans and documentation on our website. And we are working on the remote access. So today or during this week, we will have a kind of remote access. You will work in the simulation, and we will transfer your simulation to the lab, take videos, and provide you again with the videos. So the target in the lab is to have rapid algorithm prototyping, so the transfer between simulations and lab should be seamless. That means what you develop in simulations, we can apply directly in the lab, and this is what you are going to experience this week. And centralized and distributed computations are allowed in the lab. And we use an innovative service-oriented architecture, which we divide in hierarchical levels, high, mid, and low levels, which will be discussed in detail in the afternoon. And we use a middleware for data exchange and for synchronization of data. And this is a very important point if you work with multi-agent systems, to have a solid middleware where you can rely on what the infrastructure of your code is doing. And if you are at the beginning of your research, I would suggest that you don't use ROS, but use what we are going to present in the afternoon. It is more realistic, and it's going to be the future in the next years. So if you are still thinking cost is state of the art, you are maybe not totally correct. The next generation of ROS is going to be ROS 2, and the core part of ROS 2 is going to be DDS, data distribution service, which we use in the lab. And actually, if you use data distribution service, yeah, you don't need to you don't need ROS 2. You can just use the tools you would like from ROS 2. And maybe some words about data distribution service. It is a standard. It is not an implementation, and there are different implementations of it, which we use in the lab a commercial implementation till now, but we are refactoring our software, and we are integrating an open source implementation of data distribution service. So here you see the lab architecture, and again, it's going to be discussed in detail in the afternoon, but I would like to tell you here that we have a modular architecture with following the scheme of SensePlan Act, and we have also additionally an infrastructure part. And I will use this slide and this picture to show you during the course about which part I'm going to speak and where you can use the single modules. So the lab architecture, in some words, is modular to be able to replace them easily and to be able to rapidly test algorithms in the lab. So what we see here is a video of 9 vehicles driving around in the lab. Here in the background, you see the map existing now in the lab. We can replace it. It is just a plane which we can roll out and replace. So at the outer ring should simulate a motorway, and in the middle you see an intersection. It should simulate an intersection in a city. So we have here at the same time the highway or motorway and the intersection. So we have to the highway the exits and entrances, as you know from highways. Yeah, what you see here is that the vehicles drive around. They follow random trajectories. So the goals of the vehicles are chosen randomly in this example. It is actually our testing algorithm of the lab. In this example, we have also a networked MPC where the vehicles are assigned specific priorities to consider each other, to coordinate with each other. We will speak in detail about, of course, networked MPC and the priority distribution and coordination of vehicles in this course. And if I would say after this course, you will be at least able to implement such an example. So you will be able to do stuff like this after this course. You are not going to do it during the course. You will be able to do it after the course. So during the course, you are going to implement a platoon. It's also exciting, but not like this. But of course, you can do it after the course. So before starting with the course logistics, Anastasios joined us. Welcome, Anastasios. And before you joined us, we introduced ourselves and the participants, the course participants introduced their selves, and you are going to work in teams. Your team member is going, or your teammate is going to be Ivan, and he also introduced himself, but himself, maybe you want also to introduce yourself in 1 minute, just your, say your name maybe again, that I know if I pronounced right, and your topic and your progress in your PhD. No, we are not hearing you. You have to turn on your microphone.
Yeah, sorry. Good morning. My name is Anastasios Tsolakis. You can call me Tassos. I'm a PhD candidate in TU Delft in the Department of Cognitive Robotics. And my research topic is about safe cooperation in mixed traffic conditions. It's a project in cooperation of the Cognitive Robotics Department and the Maritime Department. So the application would mostly be on vessels. And the idea is to be able to have a scheme of vessels cooperating in a port, for example, while they address faults and unpredictable human behavior from human operated vessels.
Okay, very interesting. So this.
Thank you.
So we have a scheme how to consider non-autonomous vehicles in traffic. How far are you in your piece?
No, I just started this December. Yes.
Okay. So it is good to start with a course.
Yes. For us, probably model predictive control will be the approach, the base layer on which we will build other extensions, let's say, to address uncertainties and faults, basically.
Okay, nice. So now we are complete. We have the 15 participants together, and we have built the teams, and we can speak a little bit about the course logistics. So the course is divided into 4 parts. Today I speak about vehicle models, and Patrick in the afternoon will speak about architectures. Tomorrow I will start speaking about control, and I'll continue on Friday with optimization. Tomorrow, I think, and on Wednesday also, I'll speak about network and distribution. And what I said, Patrick is going to speak about software architectures and testing concepts in the afternoon. So we will post the course materials on Skibo. So you should have received all links you need for this course. So the lab, so the course is divided into two parts. It's 21 hours. Like 10 hours are going to be lecture, 10 hours working in the lab, and the last hour is going to be your presentations. Here we see how the you apply the techniques from lecture in the lab. So it is in general control and optimization. You are going not to do anything with perception. And here we see the network and distribution if we have more than one agent. And the whole system is built in the framework of software architectures and testing concepts. The lecture style is going to be presentations. I will present concepts to you, and we will try to have some group discussions. So I, it's not possible to replace the physical meeting completely, but I'll try to have some interactions with you, and you maybe noticed, yeah, we started today with introductions, and we got to know a little bit about each other. So we will have an attendance list. The organizers of EECI will provide you with certificates about this course. And for this, Patrick, before starting each part, each 3 hours part, will check the participants in Zoom. And yeah, at the end, we will see, we have to provide this list to the organizers. Yeah, for the lab work, you are going to work in teams. Now you should know your team mates. And I thought for your work in the lab, you should be able to get a prize. And the prize is going to be, as I said, we are going to present, you are going to present your results on Friday. And for every working solution, so again, working solution, not perfect, not right, just working. For every working solution, I'll donate 15 euros for a good cause. So this should motivate you to have working solution. If you have a working solution, I'll have less money. You can also decide where the money should go for. If you don't tell me, I'll just look myself for a good cause. And we will have also a second prize. The second prize is going to be an invitation of the best solution for to spend a week with us here, of course, after Corona. And yeah, now I don't know when Corona is passed. I can't tell you how much I can contribute to your visit here. So we would announce the best solution on Friday, and we will invite you to spend the week with us after Corona. And when you are ready to visit us, I will check how can I contribute to your visit to support you with travel costs and maybe staying costs. I don't know by now, but we will do our best when you did your best to get the best solution. So we will do also our best to support you. So we did the diagnostic test. Actually, I can go through the results with you that you know why I did it and how the results are. Yeah. Oh, we already have the number 15. So everyone answered. So yeah, you see your backgrounds. 6 are from automation engineering, 1 mechanical, 3 computer, and 5 others. The others are actually electrical or mechatronics. So here you see your pre-knowledge in the single areas. Most of you know what is a differential equation is, Laplace transform, transfer function. Yeah. Part of you know about vehicle models, so we'll go fast through it. Control loop, fortunately, everyone knows what is a control loop is. Block diagram, stability, PID, LQR, digital control, state space. This is our good news that everybody knows what is state space. Some of you already know about model predictive control, and I considered this knowledge to mix the teams. So I have, if you have no knowledge, I chose that you work with somebody with knowledge. Yeah, and I also will consider, for example, here graph theory. Some of you don't have any knowledge in graph theory, so I will introduce graph theory, but very shortly. It's not going to be a long introduction. Yeah, you see also everybody has knowledge in programming, good or very good. This is also good news. I think just little of you don't know about MATLAB, and I use that to mix the teams. So you see you have common interests, but also different backgrounds, and I try to mix the teams that we can get the best of you. So here is the schedule for this week. We are in the introduction. We are already over the time, but don't worry, we'll save time in models. In the afternoon, you will hear about architectures, and you will start today working in the lab simulation, and you will start, of course, with basics. Yeah, tomorrow I'll introduce model predictive control. You will continue working in the lab basics. In the afternoon, I will introduce the network part, and you will start implementing a CMPC. On Wednesday, I'll finish the network part, and you will continue working on CMPC, and maybe you can start working on DMPC on Wednesday. On Wednesday evening, we will have our social event. Yeah, Patrick has prepared some games. It should be not just games. We can also interact and discuss things. Maybe not about the networked MPC, maybe in general, but what you would like. And if you know how to use this time slot, the social event, if you have useful ideas, maybe not so useful, maybe just games, you can just suggest them now to Patrick, or just wait for Wednesday, and you can just suggest things, and we will do it. So on Thursday, it's going to be completely a lab working day. So you will work on the implementation of the MPC for platoon control, and in the evening, so by 6 p.m., you are going to submit your solution, which will be conducted in the lab by Patrick. If you don't finish and want to continue learning in the evening, don't worry. We can try to conduct your experiment also on Friday morning. So I'll do the control, the last control part. It's going to be a scheme of non-convex optimization on Friday. You will present your lab work, then we will wrap up, do some assessments, announce the best solution, and hope to see you then again. So sometimes before we start, the course is not going to be about automated or autonomous vehicles, but we assume that we have autonomous vehicles, and for this it's good to have some background and to know a little bit about automated vehicles. So we have, depending on the association who defined the levels of automation, different definitions of levels of automation. But the internationally most discussed one is the one from the Society of Automotive Engineers. And they define five levels of automation. Level one or level zero is no automation. Level one, you can you have to have your hands on the wheel, on the steering wheel. In level two, you can take your hands off. Level three, you can take your eyes off for some seconds. In level four, you can take your mind off. That means you can read newspaper or whatever. And in level five, steering wheel is optional. And yeah, in this course, we assume that we have autonomous vehicles. If they are not autonomous, we automate them that they are autonomous. But we will also consider how to consider non-autonomous vehicles. So there are further definitions of automation. I just listed here the one from the US and the one from Germany. So we'll also speak about networked vehicles, and this is not actually a definition, and the community is still not far in this topic, not far as in single automated vehicles. It is more my or let's say yeah, some points how to define network vehicles. So some people also call them connected. So if you consider ground vehicles, or let's say road vehicles, they are nowadays more called connected, but don't worry, networked and connected are synonyms. So they have vehicle to X communications. So some communications between vehicles, and we say here X because we assume communications in general between vehicles, and X is everything. Could be other vehicles, could be infrastructure, I'd say it could be anything. And we have, the network vehicles consist of interacting vehicles. They interact with each other. They have something common. They have maybe a common goal, or they coordinate to solve commonly a certain problem. Maybe to be efficient in crossing an intersection. Yeah, and they should contribute to better perception and decision-making, and the focus of this course is going to be on decision-making. So there are many challenges arising from the network of vehicles. They are on computation time and communications, and we will speak in this course about the challenges and how to face these challenges. They consider feasibility, that we get feasible solutions of the network system, and they consider also the quality of solutions we get. So the next part is going to be the vehicle models. So before continuing, I would end or stop the slide sharing, and if you have comments, questions about the introduction, so just feel free to turn on your microphone, just unmute yourself and ask.
Hi, Bassam. Sorry, one of the students asked about the recordings files, and you mentioned that probably it will be available later on. Is it possible to have them at the same day of the course, if you want to review it during the evening or something like that? Is it possible to have access to the recording files in the same day as the course? For example, can you make them available during whatever you record today? Can you make them available today?
I don't know exactly. We have a student who will take care of cutting our videos. So, Patrick, do you know when we can provide the recordings?
I mean, the raw footage you could provide really soon.
But I guess that should be sufficient just for reviewing purposes.
Okay, then it's fine.
Thanks.
You're welcome. So if you don't have further comments, I would continue. So to go back to my pad. And now, yeah, we will start now with vehicle models. So it is the first part of the course. And yeah, looking at the lab architecture, where we can use vehicle models, actually everywhere, but I have chosen the Sense Plan Act. So in every module, we can use the vehicle models. So they are useful. So in every part, I will also start presenting the main source, the main literature I'm taking the lecture from. So the vehicle models are taken from Vehicle Dynamics and Control, the book written by Rajamani. I think this is from the book I have is from 2005, but there are also more recent editions. Yeah, for further literature, I've also considered the models written by Professor Althoff from the TU Munich, and the tool is called Common Road. And if you click on the slide on the link, you get directly to the repository. Of the website of Common Road. And further literature too, so I differentiate between further literature one and two. One are not my own written literature, and two are my own written literature. So literature is the main source. Literature one are literature written by, not by myself, and two are written by myself. So we will start with a recap about control loops. So just to recap the elements of a control loop. So we have the control variable, which we want to control. We measure it, so it is the sense part. We feed it back to compare it with the reference. The reference is what some people say also the wish, what we wish to have. It is, for example, if we have speed control in a vehicle and we the driver wish to have 100 kilometers per hour, then it is the reference and we compare it with the control variable with the measured speed, and the measured speed is, for example, 90. Then we have a difference of 10 kilometers per hour, which we call error. And this error, as you can imagine, should be always zero. And for this, we use a controller. The controller computes control inputs, which we apply to our system, to our plant, to get the error to zero. So if we have here an error of for example 10 kilometers per hour, then the controller would do something to get the speed higher. And you see here the minus sign is very important in control loops, in general in control. If we have a higher speed than desired, then we have a negative error, and the controller should get this error to zero, of course. And if we have a less speed than the desired one, then the error is positive, and from the other side, the controller should get the value to zero. And in each control loop, you maybe, or in each also control scheme, you always see disturbances. Disturbances are very important for control. So this this is the thing which we don't desire, but they are there, and we have to consider them to get our system controlled in the way that we want, that we desire. So without disturbances, we don't need actually control, because we can then plan the feature. So if you imagine in this control loop, we don't have the disturbances, then we don't need this feedback. We can control, or we can design a controller which can consider the feature, and which can get errors to zero because we don't have disturbances to which we have to get rid of, to get out of our eliminate them, we say also. So this is just a very short introduction to control loops. And I'm not going here to define these terms, but you saw we have a plant, so we have a model of our plant, or we call it also process. In case of vehicles, it is the vehicle itself. So what I want to distinguish between in this course, and I would like you to notice, is that we have two models, two kind of models. We have a model of our process, of our vehicles, for simulation. So we simulate our system using a model, and we have maybe the same, but maybe a different model for setting up our controller. And why we distinguish between both? We want to simulate reality as accurate as possible. So we use a model to simulate the reality, but in the controller, maybe real-time issues are more important than the accuracy, and we choose a different model in our controller, which is going to be model predictive control in this course. So just keep this definition in mind. When I say model, you should know this model is for simulation, or this model is for control.
Sorry, I have a question concerning the difference between the two models. You mean that if we use the same model as in the plant of our control loop and in the plant of the MPC, we will have a computational, more computational effort, or the result will be perfect? Like, I didn't get the point.
Yeah, you're right. Maybe it wasn't very clear. So if you use the same model in simulation and in the control of MPC, then your result should be very perfect. Yeah. But usually we want to simulate reality as accurate as possible. So we put here for the plant simulation, maybe I choose other color. For the plant simulation, we use an accurate model with I don't remember who is working on model reduction. Joy, you know, Joy, why we do model reduction? Maybe for computation time of models. So maybe we use in our plant in general, not in this course, PDEs. PDEs are computationally very very heavy, and maybe we cannot in many cases we cannot compute them in real time. But we want to control such systems, such maybe multi-physics systems, as in your example, Joy. Then we have to find a representation of this model, a mathematical representation, which is sufficient enough in accuracy and the complexity is low enough to get our system controlled in real time. It is a trade-off between complexity and computation time.
Okay, thank you.
So again, a slide about models. Model reflects only a part of the characteristics of the original, what I now actually said in this example. So here we have reality, here we have the model. In reality, we have our process controlled by our controller. And in model, we have a model of the process and a model of the controller. And in simulations, we do our controller design and transfer back to reality to control the real system, which we indeed want to control. So in this course, we are going to work in simulation in most parts of the course. So we are going to be here. So we're going to work with the simulation. And on Thursday afternoon or evening, or when you finish your solutions, Patrick will transfer your code to the lab. And here we will have the lab. And here we will have your controller. And we will test your controllers and you will see the result. So this is in few words, how the week is going to be. So when we speak about modeling, we have to go systematically through a modeling process. And for this, we have in the first step to define our modeling goal. So we, if we take the example of vehicles, we can model everything in the vehicles as we can using physics. What we cannot what we don't know how to model using physics, we can maybe identify and use mathematical equations to describe. So we can describe a system in a very, very, very complex way. But this is not what control is about. In control, we have a control variable which we want to control. And the first part in the first step, the very first step in our modeling and control is to define our goal. So what do you want to do? For example, in the example of speed control, I don't care about maybe the I don't know if it is I don't care about the lateral dynamics of the vehicle. Other people, other controller takes care of the lateral dynamics. I just want to control the vehicle in the longitudinal direction. So I have to build a model for the longitudinal dynamics of the vehicle. And this is what you are going to do in this course. So the goal is the first thing we do. Yeah, the second thing is we meet assumptions. We cannot model everything in as in reality in using physics and mathematical equations. We have to meet assumptions, and this considers the question of manner. We have to we have a trade-off between complexity and computation time, for example. So the third thing we do in our modeling process is to describe it verbally, to have a verbal description of our model. Till now, it is you don't need to be an engineer to model a system, and this part, the verbal description, is also very important to communicate with other disciplines. So what we are going to have in this course, I try to mix the teams depending on the background, and maybe you can use the verbal description to understand each other. Then we draw a block diagram of our model, and yeah, a block diagram is defined in standards, and actually maybe you have different names of block diagrams in you learn other terms of block diagram, but a block diagram is nothing else than this thing here. So we have the parts of the system in blocks and signals between the blocks. So then we write the model equations down, differential equation usually, because we are interested in dynamical systems. So we write the differential equations down. They could be based on physics or on identifications. So they could be physically motivated or mathematically motivated. And of course, what you always do, hopefully, after a process, you validate your process, you validate your model. So we will need a model validation, how to test and where we test our model. Is our model complex enough? Is our model simple enough for our goal? So I would suggest to have a break at this point. So I'll stop the screen sharing, but the Zoom room is open, and yeah, you can do what you want. You can discuss or leave the room or discuss with your teammates, what you ever want. We meet again at 11. I hope everybody is fine with 22 minutes break. Okay, see you later.